Okay, so what we have discussed much earlier is about the complete renal pathology discussed, the normal histology, the different microscopies, the different kind of deposits, glomerulonephritis, everything. So this is completely an image-oriented session of the renal pathology. So let's rush through the images over here. So most of the images are from your textbook Robbins only. So this is what we are talking about, the normal light microscopic appearance of the normal glomerulus. So these outermost cells, which are yellow in color, these are nothing but the parietal epithelial cells. And these blue colored cells are nothing but the visceral epithelial cells. For understanding purpose, these food processes are shown over here, but normally on light microscopy, you couldn't appreciate these things. And these green colored cells are nothing but the mesangial cells. And these orange color cells are nothing but the endothelial cells of the nothing but the fenestrated endothelium. You can also appreciate the fenestration seen over here. These are the fenestrations. The size of the fenestration is almost up to 70 to 100 nanometers. Yeah. And in between there is a maroon colored linear structure. See, if you could able to make out this structure, see this one. Yes, this maroon colored linear structure is nothing but the glomerular basement membrane. So this is all about the structure of the glomerulus. Hope you understood this. And we have clearly discussed all the other features of these things. Okay. So once again, go through these things. This is the parietal epithelial cell. This blue colored cell is a visceral epithelial cell. And these green cells are the mesangial cells. These brown colored cells are the endothelial cells. And this maroon colored structure, what you're looking at is the glomerular basement membrane. And another thing is the urinary space is as what you know is just the in between the parietal and visceral layer. So this becomes the urinary space. So this is the urinary space which you can come across over here. Fine. So what you're looking at is the normal HND. What you're looking at is a normal HND and on light microscopy. Light microscopy. So this is a normal kidney. So what you're looking at is these are the parietal epithelial cells. These are the nuclei of the parietal epithelial cells. Okay. So we can write over here as parietal epithelial cells. So this being the nucleus of the visceral epithelial cells. Hope you can make out clearly that the food processes are not visible over here. And these are the capillary lumens. These are the glomerular capillary lumens. Glomerular capillary. In between these nuclei and these cells are nothing but the, yes, these are the mesangial cells. And what exactly is this? Is the, yeah, this is the urinary space. This is the urinary space. And very adjacent to it, there are some cells with large eosinophilic cytoplasm. So these are nothing but the proximal convoluted tubules. These are the proximal convoluted tubules. Okay. This is also a proximal convoluted tubule. Yes. Next is about the normal glomerulus with some special stains. What is it called? PAS. Okay. PAS is periodic acid sheaf. We discussed that there are some special stains with which you can make out the compare the thickness of the basement membrane with the tubular basement membrane. See. So this is the tubular basement membrane, and this is the basement membrane which you could able to appreciate over here. Okay. So this. Okay. This is the basement membrane of the glomerulus. This is the basement membrane of the tubule with which we generally compare these two things. So this is the normal PAS of a glomerulus. Okay, the glomerulus still is very normally looking. It has no pathology identified over on this PAS also. Next, another special stain which is helpful to know about the membrane. This is another one is called silver stain. As you all know, silver stain will have a black colored appearance of the membrane. So all the capillaries are having this black lining. It is nothing but the basement membrane. See, it is very clear over here. This is the basement membrane, the black thing. Okay. So this is another special stain what we use. This image is very beautifully depicted and describes all the normal structures and all the normal functions of all the electron microscopic view of the glomerulus. As we discussed while drawing this image, imagine as if a small part of it is magnified. A small part of it is magnified, and that one is this. So superiorly, it is a glomerular capillary lumen. Means if you can extend like this, it will be like this. This is a glomerular capillary lumen. What you're looking at are nothing but the fenestration, and I told you the fenestrations between the endothelial cells are of 70 to 100 nanometers, and what you're looking little outer aspect is this basement membrane. As such, basement membrane will be having your central lamina densa and inner laminar area interna and outer laminar area externa. This is all about the glomerular basement membrane, and we discussed about the components or the composition of the glomerular basement membrane is made up of type 4 collagen. Type 4 collagen again will be having alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3, alpha 4, alpha 5 and alpha 6. The most common trimer always will be alpha 1, alpha 2 and alpha 1. So what you're looking, other substances which form the normal glomerular basement membrane are collagen type 4, laminin, fibronectin, antactin, perlecan and heparin sulfate. So these are all the substances which build up the molecule of the glomerular basement membrane. And this after outside of which you come across the visceral epithelial cell, also called as a podocyte, which will be having the food processes. So here this is the visceral epithelial cell, this is the nucleus of the visceral epithelial cell. And outside you come across the visceral epithelial cell, you come across the urinary space or the Bowman space, wherein which all the urine will be filtered out, after which you have the parietal epithelial cell. So if you observe a very important thing, parietal cell has nothing to do with the filtration barrier. The filtration barrier is formed only by three cells, only by three structures, one being the endothelial cell, the middle one is the basement membrane, and outer one is visceral epithelial cell. Parietal cell has nothing to do with the filtration barrier. So only these three structures put together called as a filtration barrier. So please be very clear, you may come across an MCQ in your physiology asking which of the following is not a part of the glomerular basement membrane, is not a part of the filtration barrier. Yeah, and as you all know, all black and white images are electron microscopic images. So this is a real electron microscopic image showing a normal glomerulus. So what you're looking at, these are the food process, these are the visceral epithelial cells, these are the visceral epithelial cells, these are the gaps between the visceral epithelial cells, which will be around 20 to 30 nanometers. And this is an endothelial cell, this is an endothelial cell. So what you're looking at is the basement membrane, this is the basement membrane. So this, the central darker structure is the lamina densa, and outer one is the laminar area interna and externa. This is the electron microscopic image of this glomerulus. So this we are already discussing. The glomerular basement membrane normal dimensions are 300 to 400 nanometers. The significance of remembering the thickness of this is, in some diseases like Alport syndrome, it will be irregularly thickened and thinned out, and in another disease called familial thin membrane disease also, it will be very much thinned out. And endothelial gap junctions always will be 70 to 100 nanometers, whereas the epithelial means the gaps or the spaces between the visceral epithelial cells will be 20 to 30 nanometers. Okay, you need to remember the statistics. Okay, fine. Yeah, this is the most common trimer. As I told you, alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3, alpha 4, alpha, alpha 6, are the six types of alpha chains present in the glomerular basement membrane. The most common trimer as such will be 1 to 1. So, never been asked as a question, but this is one of a very important topic, and you can expect this as a MCQ in near future. The most common trimer combination will be 1, 2 and 1. Yes. And yesterday we are discussing about the newer stages of a chronic kidney disease. Earlier it was renal insufficiency, decreased renal reserve, renal insufficiency, renal failure and end-stage renal disease. Now it has been classified into stage 1 to stage 5 on the basis of the GFR. So kidney failure is called if the GFR is less than 15, okay, with normal or increased GFR is more than or equal to 90, with mildly decreased, with moderately decreased, severe decrease and chronic renal failure. So the new classification of staging of a chronic kidney disease. Next one is, another important thing is, a normal protein which is secreted by the tubular epithelial cell called Tom Hartzell protein. And many times asked MCQ is about which produces this Tom Hartzell protein. It is nothing but the thick ascending loop of Henle. Okay, so it is the thick ascending loop of Henle. So thick ascending loop of Henle secretes a protein called Tom Hartzell protein, which is a normal protein. This protein combines with some other substances and it forms the cast, and that cast is formed in distal convoluted tubule. So don't confuse with this. So cast as such is formed in the distal convoluted tubule, but Tom Hartzell protein is produced in the thick ascending loop of Henle. Okay, fine. Next one. Now next, let's move into the cast. So cast, as such I told you, these are certain molds of left out or secreted protein with some added substances, which will be seen excreted in the urine. So they have some significance. Each caste has its own significance. So we need to remember those castes and the conditions along with the conditions where it is seen. So normally this caste is formed in the distal conventricular tubule, and the most composition of this caste is nothing but the atomic horse wall protein with some other added substances. So generally we come across in any dehydration or severe exercise, you come across a caste which can be seen in even normal healthy individuals, that is called as a hyaline caste. Why it is called as a hyaline caste is, it is somewhat glassy, transparent, which you can only make out if the illumination is much decreased. So this is called as a hyaline caste. So you may also come across a question which of the caste is not pathological. So the caste which is not pathological is hyaline caste, which can be seen in normal individuals or even after strenuous exercise. Next one, what you are looking at is a granular caste. So if you could able to make out, you could able to appreciate this outlines which are much granular. So this is called as a granular caste. So granular caste also less number of cases it can be seen normal, and you may come across about what could be the composition of the granules. These granules may be a plasma, these granules may be some proteins or some granules of the WBC or maybe some other plasma protein. So this is all about a granular caste. This is also a granular caste. So next, what is it you are looking at is a RBC caste. What is it you are looking at? A RBC caste. How to make out that it is an RBC? If you could appreciate this, this is an RBC which is showing a central pallor. So here also you could be able to make out RBC with a central pallor. RBC is a central pallor. This is called an RBC caste. So RBC caste is nothing but along with the normal caste, these RBCs will be attached or studded to the surface of the caste. Is called as an RBC caste, which is specific of some glomerulonephritis, more specifically your post-streptococcal glomerulonephritis. So this is all about the RBC caste, which can be asked as a MCQ, which was already asked, I guess. So this is a RBC caste which is seen in post-streptococcal glomerulonephritis. So next, what you are looking at is a WBC caste. It is a WBC caste. So WBC caste, in the sense, the same the normal protein of which you come across studying of these WBCs. You come across studying of this with WBCs, which is more in favor of any tubular inflammations like your pyelonephritis and all. You come across a WBC caste. So pyelonephritis can be, you come across this WBC caste. And next and most important, if you compare this caste with this caste, so obviously it is looking much wider. So this is called as a broad caste with sharp angle. So this is called broad caste or broad waxy caste, which is characteristic and specifically seen in chronic renal failure. This was asked repeatedly as an MCQ. So what is this caste? So much larger dimensions, which is generally seen in chronic renal failure. This is called as a broad cast or a waxy cast. So with this, we are done with the cast. Next, also have a look about the crystals. See, there are three things which can be seen in a urine. So three components can be seen in urine. One is cells, other one is cast, and the third one is crystals. The information what a cast can give is already what we discussed. These cells are already discussed. RBC, WBC, epithelial cells are only the cells which you come across in urine microscopy. And coming to the crystal, so as such, you know, there are certain types of renal calculi, and respective renal calculi will be having the respective crystals in the urine. So on the basis of which you could able to make out the composition of the calculi which a person is having, okay, or any severe dehydrations or severe electrolyte imbalance, also you come across this crystals. So calcium oxalate crystals, if you could able to make out, there is a peculiar shape called envelope shape. If you want, I can just draw this for you. So this is called an envelope shape crystal. So envelope shape crystal is, this is seen in calcium oxalate. So calcium oxalate, the most common cause is if you eat any diet which is rich in oxalate like spinach, tomatoes and all, this is one of the cause where you come across calcium oxalate crystals, or more intake of calcium also can cause this calcium oxalate crystals. What is the shape of the crystal? Is the envelope shape. You may directly come across an MCQ focusing giving a picture of this cast and giving a picture of this crystal and be asking you which stone the person may be having or what is the composition of the crystal and all. So envelope shape is generally seen in calcium oxalate. The next one is a triple phosphate. Triple phosphate, nothing but you may also come across this as also called strobite stone, also called as your staghorn calculi. Okay. So you may come across a person maybe having Staghorn calliculi or a Strouvite stone, or you can also call it as a triple phosphate stone. The three phosphates which present in this triple phosphate, easy way to remember as CAM, okay, C-A-M. Calcium, ammonium, magnesium, phosphate are the three phosphate. If you have an observation of the image which we focused, it has a coffin lid appearance. It has a coffin lid or coffin box appearance of the crystals, okay, fine. So this is all about this. This is all about this triple phosphate or Struvite stone or Staghorn stone, which have a coffin lid appearance of the crystals. Next one is about a calcium carbonate. So calcium carbonate, most of the crystals will be spherical. Most of the crystals will be spherical. If you have a close resolution or closer view of this, it will be having some radiating lines all over. It will be having some radiating lines all over, the characteristic feature of a calcium carbonate stone. It will be spherical with radiating lines to the center. That is of calcium carbonate stone. This is a calcium carbonate stone. Next is about the cysteine stone. Most of the time it will be hexagonal. Most of the time it will be hexagonal. This is the shape of a cysteine stone. Mostly seen in cases who will be having this cystinuria, cystinosis, or any cysteine related abnormalities. This being one of the hardest stone. This being one of the hardest stone. So these patients who are having cysteine stone are cannot undergo extracorporeal shockwave lithotripsy. They need to go for an open surgery. Another unique feature of the cysteine stone is this stone, as soon as it is removed from the body, can change its color on exposure to the atmospheric air. Can change its color on exposure to the atmospheric air. So please remember three important things about cysteine stone. This is the hardest stone. The reason why you cannot do extracorporeal shockwave lithotripsy, and this stone on exposure to air mostly changes its color. And next important thing about this being the hardest, what being the most easily fragmented stone is uric acid stone. Uric acid stone is not that hard. It is one of the stone which is very easy to fragment on ESWL. Okay, fine. And next, tyrosine is almost like radiating lines or some this fiber-like appearance is seen with the tyrosine crystal. So this is about the tyrosine crystal seen in any tyrosine amino acid metabolism. Yeah. And this, while we are talking about other aspect of, you have three microscopies: light microscopy, electron microscopy, immunofluorescence. So light microscopy, what structures you see, you have already seen. What you cannot make out of presence or absence of food process, the exact thickness of the basement membrane, you cannot make out on light microscopy. Whereas the details of these two can be made on electron microscopy. So you can able to make out the presence or absence of food process on electron microscopy. The exact location of the deposits you can make out, and the exact dimensions of the basement membrane also you can measure on electron microscopy. And what we can make out on immunofluorescence, we discussed it is about the exact pattern of the deposit, whether it is a fine granular, coarse granular, or linear, you can make out. And you can also make out the composition of the deposit, whether it is IgG or IgM or any alternate pathway complement is there, or this classical pathway complement is there, or IgA is there. So these things can be made out on immunofluorescence. So this mostly is to give you a rough idea of the different types of deposits in a normal image. Okay, fine. So what you're looking at, so again, get back to the normal orientation. So these innermost things are your endothelial cells. These are the endothelial cells, and this dark red color structure is your basement membrane, and this sky blue colored cell is your visceral epithelial cell, and these green colored cells are the mesangial cells. So let's see, or let's look on about this one. So what is this one, which deposit it is? So this deposit is seen in between your visceral epithelial cell and the basement membrane, so which makes it a subepithelial deposit. Okay, is it very clear? Yes, it is very clear. So it is a subepithelial deposit. Now let's move on to two. So two is something related to which is again subepithelial, but it is close to the membrane. Okay, it is close to the membrane. So this is almost, this should be the exact way of drawing this. So this is called membranous deposit. So what is this? This is membranous deposit. And three, so three is in between the endothelium and the basement membrane. So it is called subendothelial deposit. It is subendothelial deposit. And four is what you come across as a mesangial deposit. So these are the deposits which you come across in different diseases over here. So subepithelial, membranous, subendothelial, and mesangial deposits we have already seen. Yes, the next one is about